Okay, sorry for that brief interruption. Let us continue. I'm going to rewind this back so we can pick up where we left off.
Israelites' failure to obey God's commands would lead to the Israelites being took over by curses, same word used. This shows the Babylonian captivity was the fulfillment of the Deuteronomy 28 curses. Thirdly, referring to the Babylonian destruction of Jerusalem and captivity in the 6th century BC, Lamentations 4:10 mentions how the Israelites were starving so bad they ate their own children. This fulfills the curse in Deuteronomy 28:53, which says, "And you shall eat the fruit of your womb, the flesh of your sons and daughters, whom the Lord your God has given you, in the siege and in the distress with which your enemies shall distress you." I am not aware of African Americans eating their children due to famine after first being sieged and occupied by Americans. Fourthly, Deuteronomy 28:63 refers to the Israelites being taken from Israel by a nation, not being taken from Africa or the land of Ham to the United States. It says, "And you shall be plucked off the land that you are entering to take possession of it," end quote. In the Deuteronomistic historical context, the land the Israelites were entering and taking possession of here was the land of Canaan they would conquer and rename as Israel. Thus, it is impossible for this text to refer to African-American slavery. Fifthly, fake black Israelites falsely claim Deuteronomy 28:68 predicts Africans going on slave ships to America. Quote, "And the Lord will bring you back in ships to Egypt," i.e. the supposed symbolic America, "a journey that I promise that you should never make again. And there you shall offer yourselves for sale to your enemies as male and female slaves, but there will be no buyer," end quote. Commenting on this verse, fake black Israelite Elisha Israel writes, "History undeniably reveals to us who was hoarded on ships and sold on auction blocks as bondmen and bondwomen, as is described in Deuteronomy 26:68. Only those stripped from Africa have endured being captured as slaves and transported by way of ships to the Americas, Europe, and Asia," end quote. However, this is historically incorrect. The ancient Jews were put on ships and sold as slaves throughout the world by the emperors Titus and Hadrian in the 1st and 2nd centuries AD, and this is when the Deuteronomic curses were fully fulfilled. Here is the history. In AD 70, the Roman commander Titus, who would later become the emperor, amassed troops and invaded Jerusalem, destroying the temple and murdering and enslaving the Jewish population. This happened during the first Jewish war against the Romans between AD 66 and 70, and it led to a great famine in Jerusalem, according to the ancient historian Josephus. This fulfills the hunger or famine curses in Deuteronomy 28:48. Also, Josephus tells us that due to this famine, the Jews were forced to survive by eating their own children, which fulfills the cannibalism curse in Deuteronomy 28:53. By the way, these famine curses were also fulfilled during the Babylonian captivity. Now, Roman commander Titus had 97,000 Jews enslaved and 1,100,000 Jews murdered in Jerusalem. Josephus informs us that those above the age of 17 years old were transported on ships to the Egyptian mines to do labor as slaves. This fulfills the slavery curse, which again says, "And the Lord will bring you back in ships to Egypt." This text has nothing to do with Africans coming to America on ships. Those that were under 17 years old were sold as slaves, and many others were transported to other provinces as prisons to be destroyed in gladiator games by the sword or by beasts. Something similar happened under Emperor Hadrian's Roman reign in the next century. After the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70, slowly the city was rebuilt and many Jews returned to it. The Jews even built an altar on the destroyed Temple Mount, and thus temple ritual was temporarily reinstated. The Roman 10th Legion troops stayed in Jerusalem to keep order. Then a Jewish resistance arose called the Bar Kokhba fortified walls in which you trusted come down throughout all your land. This was not fulfilled in Africa. At this time, many Jews also died due to starvation from famine, and many were enslaved by Emperor Hadrian, who then banned all Jews from entering Jerusalem. Professor of Jewish history Shmuel Safray notes, particularly notorious was the Terebinth Market north of Hebron, where Jewish slaves captured by Hadrian were sold in such large numbers that, according to one report, a Jewish slave could be bought for a horse's ration, end quote. This fulfills the Deuteronomy 28:68 statement that, quote, there you shall offer yourselves for sale to your enemies as male and female slaves, but there will be no buyer, end quote. Were there no buyers of African-American slaves? No, there were many buyers. Likewise, George Williams notes, at this time, many Jews, quote, were sold as slaves at Hebron or at Gaza, which hence received the name of Hadrian's Mark, while the remainder were transported to the slave markets of Egypt, and thence dispersed throughout the world, end quote. This dispersing of the Jews after being put in slave markets in Egypt fulfills the curse of Deuteronomy 28:64, which says, then the Lord will scatter you among all the nations, from one end of the earth to the other. There you will worship other gods, gods of wood and stone, which neither you nor your ancestors have known. This Deuteronomy scattering curse was also fulfilled during the Assyrian exile in 722 BC, where the 10 lost tribes of Israel were scattered throughout the world. Thus, all the Deuteronomy 28 curses relating to death, slavery, slave ships, slavery in Egypt, labor work, occupation, famine, cannibalism, and Jews dispersing throughout the world were clearly fulfilled during these historical Jewish events we discussed, and not by African Americans who are not even Israelites. Fake black Israelism assumes there was Jewish mass migration to West Africa after the tribe of Judah was exiled and dispersed during the Babylonian captivity in the 6th century BC and after the Jewish-Roman Wars in AD 70 and 135. Fake black Israelites claim prior to being sold as slaves and brought to America, this supposed mass migration of Israelites to West Africa occurred, so that later African-American slaves are the descendants of the tribe of Judah. However, there's no evidence for this. Therefore, the Africans who came to America as slaves were not the Jews. Instead, after the Babylonian exile, for example, many Judeans remained in Babylon to live, and others returned to Israel. The rest were dispersed throughout the entire world in Mesopotamia, Arabia, Egypt, Asia Minor, Thrace, and Rome. They did not all just migrate to Africa, as fake black Israelites assume. Based on the early evidence, Maristella Bonacini and Zvi Eckstein note, in the 1st century, 1 million Jews lived in the Parthian Empire, 1 million in North Africa, mainly Egypt, between 200,000 and 400,000 in Syria and Lebanon, between 200,000 and 400,000 in Asia Minor, i.e. modern Turkey, and the Balkans, i.e. modern Albania, Bulgaria, Greece, and Yugoslavia, and another 100,000 to 200,000 lived in Western Europe, that is Italy, France, and the Iberian Peninsula. This is a very different picture than the false idea Judah just migrated to West Africa. Moreover, after the Jewish-Roman Wars in the 1st and 2nd centuries, the remaining Jews living in Jerusalem were also, quote, dispersed throughout the world, as George William notes, as opposed to West Africa. Now, although we have evidence of some migration of Jews to Northern Africa, mainly Egypt, the fact is the number of Jews living there evaporated as time went on. Bodicini and Eckstein note the leading scholars of ancient Jewish demography affirm that by the 7th century AD, these Jews who were originally 1 million in North Africa, mainly Egypt, reduced in size to, quote, no more than a few thousand, end quote, since in the 7th century, records prove 75% of all Jews worldwide instead lived in Mesopotamia and Persia, not West Africa. The remaining 25% of Jews worldwide were in Europe, Israel, the Balkans, Asia Minor, and Lebanon, not West Africa. Indeed, in the 7th century, only 4,000 Jews remained in Africa. These 4,000 then expanded in size to around 30,000 by AD 1170. However, these Jews in Africa were then decimated due to plagues and famines in AD 1201 to 1202, as well as the Black Death in 1348, which continued to drastically reduce the Jewish population in Africa even into the 15th century. Given these facts, it's impossible to say the 400,000 or so West African slaves who were brought to America were the Jews of the tribe of Judah. There were just not enough Jews living in Africa during that time to make such an idea possible, and we know that Jews actually migrated around the world. Thus, it was actual West Africans who came to America as slaves, not Jews. This fact is confirmed by genetics research as well, which we will now discuss. A 2015 genetic study by K. Bryce et al. In the American Journal of Human Genetics, using high-density genotype data, showed African Americans show average proportions of 73.2% African, 24% European, and 0.8% Native American ancestry. Thus, African Americans do not have ancestry from Israel. Moreover, using genome-wide nuclear markers, a 2009 study by the University of Pennsylvania called The Genetic Structure and History of Africans and African Americans likewise revealed the ancestry of African Americans is predominantly from Niger Kordofanian, 71%, European, 13%, and other African, 8% populations. It also revealed, quote, most African Americans are likely to have mixed ancestry from different regions of Western Africa, end quote. Hence, DNA evidence proves African Americans do not descend from Israel. They come from Africa. Fake black Israelites rely on and promote the outdated and debunked 1976 book, The 13th Tribe, written by Arthur Koestler. This book claims the modern Ashkenazi Jews of Israel and abroad who migrated from Europe after World War II do not actually descend from ancient Israelites in the Middle East, but instead Khazarian, i.e. Turkish people, who converted to Judaism in the 8th or 9th centuries in Europe. By clinging to this hypothesis, fake black Israelites claim they are justified in asserting that modern Jews in Israel and abroad are merely imposters and not real Jews. The problem is that Koestler's book has been refuted by academia and many recent genetic studies on Ashkenazi Jews. For example, in reviewing his book, the Koestler biographer David Cicerani notes it makes, quote, selective use of facts for a grossly polemical end, was risible as scholarship, and was slaughtered by the critics, end quote. Moreover, in his biography of Koestler, Michael Scamell notes Koestler's theory, quote, was almost entirely hypothetical and based on the slenderest of circumstantial evidence, end quote, and takes the book as evidence that Koestler's brain, quote, was starting to fail him, end quote. The theory that the Ashkenazi Jews came from the Turkic Khazars in Europe and not real Jews has been soundly refuted by historian and professor Zvi Enkori in his detailed 1979 response essay. The theory was also refuted more recently in a 2013 essay by Professor of Soviet and East European Jewry, Shaul Stamper, entitled, Did the Khazars Convert to Judaism? Stamper disproves the theory, noting, the view that some or all the Khazars, a Central Asian people, converted to Judaism at some point during the 9th or 10th century, is widely accepted. A careful examination of the sources, however, shows that some of them are pseudepigraphic and the rest are of questionable reliability. Many of the most reliable contemporary texts that mention Khazars say nothing about their conversion, nor is there any archaeological evidence for it. This leads to the conclusion that such a conversion never took place. He goes into detail in the essay. What is more, Professor of Jewish Studies Fred Astron likewise notes Koestler's book is, quote, outlandish speculation, unquote, end quote. The Khazar theory is widely held by scholars to be ahistorical, end quote. What about genetics? Well, the largest genetic study on Jews conducted in 2013 by Wayne State University revealed that Jews today in Israel and abroad who came from Moreover, in his 2012 book, Legacy, A Genetic History of the Jewish People, geneticist Harry Osher provided 20 years of genetics research conducted by him and many other scientists, and concluded the major Jewish groups share common Middle Eastern origin and no large-scale genetic contribution from the Turkic Khazars. What is more, appealing to autosomal DNA research, science writer Nicholas Wade notes, Ashkenazic and Sephardic Jews have roughly 30% European ancestry, with most of the rest from the Middle East, end quote. Thus, DNA proves the Ashkenazi Jews are the true descendants of the ancient Israelites from the Middle East. They are not imposters. Fake black Israelites are the imposters. As supposed evidence, the Ashkenazi Jews living in Israel and abroad are not actually ethnically linked to the ancient Israelites. The fake black Israelites misuse Revelation 2:9 and 3:9, which talk about the synagogue of Satan, which the Bible identifies as those who say they are Jews but are not. However, these two texts in Revelation were written to first century Christians in Smyrna and Philadelphia concerning Jews who lived among them. These Jews there slandered and persecuted the first century Christians in those cities. It's not about Jews today. Those Jews collaborated with local Roman officials to persecute Christianity, putting Christians in prison. Keener notes, Roman officials normally depended on informers as accusers before they would prosecute a case, and this was true of prosecution of Christians in Asia Minor in the decades immediately following Revelation's publication. Revelation 2:9's mention of poverty also points to these Jews being responsible for the economic troubles of the Christians in first century Smyrna and Philadelphia. Hence, to misunderstand these two texts in Revelation as if they apply to Ashkenazi Jews living today demonstrates a fundamental inability to interpret scripture in its historical first century context. In light of the actions of these first century accusers and persecutors in these cities, they were said to be lying when they called themselves Jews. What does this mean? Well, the point is not that they were lying about their national descent. Instead, the same theme is treated in Romans 2:28-29, which says, "For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor a circumcision outward and physical, but a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the Spirit." In other words, it's not enough to be a physical Jew or descendant of Judah. One has to prove themselves with their actions to truly be considered a Jew in God's eyes. Thus, these first century Jews in Smyrna and Philadelphia, although physical Jews descended from Judah, demonstrated they could not truly call themselves Jews due to the way they persecuted Christians. The point is not that they were of some other ethnicity. As New Testament scholar Robert Mounts notes, regardless of their national descent, they had become, by their bitter opposition to the church and its message, a synagogue carrying out the activities of God's supreme adversary, Satan. Or, as New Testament scholar Leon Morris notes, to be a Jew means more than to possess outward membership of the race. In order to try to prove the Bible predicts the awakening and regathering of African-American fake Israelites, these cults point to texts like Ezekiel 34:11-12, 37:21-22, and Jeremiah 23:5-8. Such texts mention the return of the exiled and globally dispersed Israelites back to Israel. In the case of Jeremiah 23:5-8, the regathering in Israel is said to happen after Christ's first century advent. So who is the group who fulfills this and regathered to Israel after Jesus' advent? Was it the fake black Israelites? No. They're still in America fighting amongst themselves, believing all kinds of different things. No, it was the real Jews who in 1948 were given their land back in an amazing episode of history. At this recreation of the State of Israel, we saw mass migration of the real Jews back to Israel in direct fulfillment of these prophecies. Meanwhile, fake black Israelites missed out because they aren't real Jews. They are in no position to regather and unite, migrating to Israel together. This is because they are still fighting with 48 was pivotal in this regard. In AD 70, Titus and his Roman warriors trampled on and destroyed Jerusalem, definitively ending Israel as a political entity. For many centuries since then, the Jews have been dispersed worldwide. Israel achieved statehood in 1948, and the Jews have been returning to their homeland ever since. The vision of Ezekiel 37 is coming to pass, just as predicted. Ariel, one of the original leaders of the ISUPK school, invented the 12 tribes of Israel chart that fake black Israelites use today. Many fake black Israelite websites display this chart as if it was factual. By the way, Arya again is the one who introduced the doctrine of reincarnation to the school, and he's the one who falsely predicted Jesus would return in the year 2000 and kill and enslave all white people. Well, there are serious problems with his widely used 12 tribes chart as well. The chart falsely claims that 10 lost tribes of Israel, exiled and dispersed by the Assyrians in the 8th century BC, became people groups such as the Mexicans, Cubans, American Indians, Dominicans, Haitians, Puerto Ricans, Argentinians, etc. Children of the tribe. Thus, in the 1980s and 90s, the Jewish state brought thousands of them to live in Israel. This, by implication, helps legitimize Elder's claims of the location of the lost tribes. In sum, although African Americans are not the tribe of Judah, and the 10 lost tribes did not migrate where fake black Israelites say they did, it does appear many Ethiopian Africans descend from the tribe of Dan. Now, the founder of the fake black Israelite schools, Eber Ben Yamyun, also known as Abba Bivens, taught that American Indians were Israelites. Today, fake black Israelites claim American Indians are the tribe of Gad, according to the Ten Lost Tribes chart. However, the first comprehensive treatise arguing this position in English comes from 1648 and was written by the Puritan Thomas Thorogood. He argued since Native Americans were quite easy to convert to Christianity, that must mean they were members of the Lost Ten Tribes and had an ingrained spiritual element that could be seized upon. However, this is not decisive proof. As time went on, the theory became somewhat popular, leading to biblical scholars like Thomas Jefferson and others examining it, eventually leading to the theory's refutation and abandonment among serious academics. As Zvi Ben-Dor Benit notes, more and more evidence based on increasingly sophisticated and less passionate ethnography pointed to the simple reality. The Indians were not Israelites. This was, as Popkin stated, one of the most important reasons that the Jewish Indian theory eventually died. There was simply no plausible evidence for this claim. The only real evidence found in America was a strange earthwork, a mound, discovered in Philadelphia in 1772, which for a while was taken to be the work of the Ten Lost Tribes. The debate gradually dissipated as increasingly sophisticated archaeological and ethnographic research tied it to known Native American practices, end quote. Even though the theory was refuted and there's no meaningful evidence for it, Abba Bivens and the fake black Israelites still nevertheless adopted it. After the theory was dismissed by the academic world, some fringe writers since then, as well as the Satanic Mormon Church, also adopted it and put out publications trying to argue for it. However, for a refutation of the theory written by a former Mormon bishop and molecular scientist using DNA evidence, see Simon G. Southerton's book, Losing a Lost Tribe, where he concludes that there's no evidence of Israelite descent among American Indians, as research showed a 98.6% Asian DNA connection and a 0% Middle Eastern DNA connection for American Indians. Indeed, American Indians come from the Asian peoples and are not of the tribe of Gad. Isaac's son Esau was the progenitor of the Edomites. Fake black Israelites falsely claim Esau and the Edomites were Caucasian. They also argue that since God hated Esau according to Malachi 1:3 and Romans 9:13, God therefore hates the white race as well. However, there are two major problems with this thesis. First, Esau or the Edomites were not the progenitors of the white race. The Edomites moved to the southern hill country of Judea after the Babylonian destruction of Jerusalem and exile of the Jewish people in 586 BC. Then in 163 BC, these Edomites, who became known as the Edomians, were subdued under the rule of the Jewish Maccabees, and then again by the Maccabean John Hyrcanus in 125 BC, leading to the Edomites converting to Judaism and becoming distinct members of the Jewish nation, who lived in their own colonies in the southern hill country of Judea. In the first century AD, the Edomites joined the Jews in rebellion against Rome and were obliterated, with only a few remaining refugees escaping. This is the actual history of the Edomites, and there is thus no way they were the progenitors of white people today. They got destroyed and then disappeared from history. These facts also refute the fake black Israelite lie proposed by Elijah J. Israel, that the post-exilic Edomites took over the Jews as imposters and were thus the descendants of modern Ashkenazi Jews. That is incorrect. After being conquered by the Maccabeans, they were in discernible separate colonies than the first century Jews. This is why the ancient historian Josephus was able to distinguish the Jews from the Edomites. When he wrote about first century Jewish events, the Edomites did not take over the Jews as imposters. So where do whites come from if not from Esau and his Edomite descendants? There's evidence Noah's son Japheth was instead the progenitor of the white race. Harold Hunt and Russell Gregg wrote an in-depth essay called The 16 Grandsons of Noah, where they demonstrate Japheth is the true ancestor of the whites, not Esau. And Esau came from Noah's son Shem, not Noah's son Japheth. These authors note Japheth's son Gomer had descendants called the Gomerites, who first lived in Galatia and thus became known as the Gauls. These Gomerites, or Gauls, then migrated to modern-day France and Spain. For a long time, France was therefore called Gaul, named after these Japhethite peoples. Moreover, the Gomerites also migrated to modern-day Wales, which is in southwest Great Britain. We know this because the Welsh language is called Gomereg, and because of ancient traditions that Gomer's descendants came to Britain. Gomer's sons Ashkenaz and Dagarma then populated Germany and Armenia. Indeed, Ashkenaz is the Hebrew word for Germany. What is more, Japheth's son Magog had descendants who populated Romania and Ukraine. We know this because Josephus tells us the Magogites were known as Scythians, and ancient Scythia was located in modern-day Romania and Ukraine. Also, Japheth's son Meshach had descendants who populated modern-day Russia. Meshach indeed means Moscow. Hence, whites do not come from Esau. They come from Japheth. So this idea whites are cursed or devil Edomites is historically inaccurate. Second, although later in scripture God affirms he hated Esau, nevertheless, we see earlier evidence in the book of Deuteronomy of God actually giving land to Esau and his progeny, the Edomites, and even helping them defeat their enemies, similar to how God helped Israel militarily and gave them land. This means God did not view Esau as an inherently evil, cursed, devil race, as fake black Israelites claim. For example, in Deuteronomy 2:4-5 and 21-22, we read that God gave Esau Mount Seir as their possession, and even helped them defeat the Horites in order to obtain it. You are about to pass through the territory of your brothers, the people of Esau who live in Seir, and they will be afraid of you, so be very careful. Do not contend with them, for I will not give you any of their land. No, not so much as for the sole of the foot to tread on, because I have given Mount Seir to Esau as a possession. The Lord destroyed them, i.e. the Rephaim people, before the Ammonites, and they dispossessed them and settled in their place, as he did for the people of Esau, who live in Seir, when he destroyed the Horites before them, and they dispossessed them and settled in their place, even to this day. So if Esau was an inherently cursed, evil, devil race, why did God help them defeat the Horites and give them their land? Moreover, King Saul hired an Edomite named Doeg to be the chief of his herdsmen. Would Saul hire an Edomite to this position if it was known by the Israelites that Edomites were cursed and the devil? Also, although fake black Israelites hate whites and call them Edomites, often cursing at them in the streets, Deuteronomy 23:7 explicitly warns, quote, "You shall not abhor an Edomite, for he is your brother." Hence, this theology of hate fake black Israelites teach against whites is unbiblical.
Hey, to kill little Edomite families, go on, get put to death, man.
All of this evidence against the fake black Israelite theory on Esau, all they are left with is the argument that since Esau was said to be red and hairy in Genesis 25:25, this must mean he was a hairy Caucasian and the progenitor of the white race. However, when Esau is described as red here, the Hebrew word as Admoni, the same word is used in 1 Samuel 16:12 and 17:42 to describe King David's skin complexion. 1 Samuel 17:42, for example, says, "And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, ruddy, Admoni, and handsome. instead be hated. This is their way of getting back at white people. However, this position is incompatible with scripture. They appeal to Matthew 10, 5-6, which says, "These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel," end quote. However, it is erroneous for fake black Israelites to assume that just because at this early period Jesus instructed his disciples to preach only to the Jews, that this meant this was Jesus' permanent plan. Instead of this representing Jesus and the disciples' long-term mission, Leon Morris notes, "All this means is that on this first mission, the 12 were to work in Galilee. The roads to the north and east led to Gentile territory, while that to the south went to Samaria." R.T. France likewise notes, "The geographical terms used here, way of the Gentiles, town of the Samaritans, indicate a restriction on the area to be visited, rather than a total ban on contact with Gentiles and Samaritans as such. This limited scope of mission was to apply for the initial period of proclamation until the undeniably primary focus of Jesus' mission as Messiah of Israel had been established. Only after that, and after his death and resurrection, would it be appropriate to widen the scope deliberately to include Gentile and Samaritan areas." 12 verses later, we see recognition the disciples would eventually be going out to the Gentiles. Quote, "You will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles," end quote. The fact is, if Jesus went to the Gentiles at the same time as the Jews in the beginning of the mission, instead of going to the Jews first, he would unnecessarily offend his Jewish people, who anxiously expected their king to fulfill their history and show special care for them. Thus, this was Jesus' first mission. Then afterwards, he sent his disciples to go to the Gentiles. This the Apostle Paul well understood when he said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek," end quote. Let us now discuss that second stage of the mission. In Matthew 28:18-19, Jesus said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." Jesus tells his followers to make disciples of all the nations, ethnos in the Greek. In Romans 9:24, the same Greek word is used and is translated as Gentiles, quote, "Even us whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles." These kinds of texts refute fake black Israelism. However, fake black Israelites deviously respond by claiming that when the salvation of ethnos, i.e. nations or Gentiles, is discussed in such passages, Israelites living in foreign nations are actually in view, as opposed to actual Gentiles. However, this position is refuted by a number of considerations. For example, based on Peter receiving a vision from God in Acts 10:10-15, Acts 10:34-35 explicitly affirms salvation is open to all Gentiles, not just the idea of Israelites in foreign lands, quote. "So Peter opened his mouth and said, truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him," end quote. The context of this text concerns a Gentile named Cornelius who worshipped Yahweh and was accepted by him and the Apostle Peter. Further proof this man was a true Gentile is that Cornelius is a Latin name, and he was a Roman centurion of the Italian cohort stationed in Caesarea. It does not get more Gentile than that. Moreover, in the Old Testament, there are texts affirming non-Israelite foreigners living among the Israelites were under Mosaic law and thus part of the Mosaic covenant. This means they could be saved by adhering to Mosaic covenant. Exodus 12:49 affirms, "If a stranger shall sojourn with you and would keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised. Then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native of the land. But no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. The same law shall apply to the native as to the stranger who sojourns among you," end quote. Clearly, this is referring to true Gentiles coming into the fold of the Israelites, since their families are to become circumcised. Old Testament scholar Walter Kaiser points out that in context, these strangers who were sojourning among the Israelites were of, quote, the mixed multitude who came out of Egypt with Israel and all such persons who might join them from time to time. Hence, there's no doubt these are non-Israelites. J. Daniel Hayes asks, what are the implications of the term translated as a mixed crowd? The clear stress of the Hebrew term used, Arab, is that these people were non-Israelites. Ends writes that this term indicates an ethnic mixture of peoples, end quote. Also, in Revelation 7:4-9, at the end of the tribulation and at Christ's return, 144,000 people from the 12 tribes of Israel are saved, as well as a countless multitude of Gentiles from every nation, people, tribe, and language. Thus, Gentiles can be saved, not just members of the 12 tribes. This is explicit. Lastly, although many people think the end of Mark 16 is inauthentic, the fact is fake black Israelites believe it is authentic, as do a number of scholars based on a recent book called The Original Ending of Mark by Nicholas P. Lunn, arguing for its authenticity. And in Mark 16:15, Jesus explicitly says, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation, end quote. Notice the whole creation, not just Israelites. They claim Revelation 3:9 supports the idea of whites being slaves of blacks in the future kingdom, since it says, behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews and are not but lie, behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you, end quote. However, we already demonstrated earlier this text refers to Jews in first century Smyrna and Philadelphia who persecuted Christians in those cities, and although they were ethnically Jewish, their actions have forfeited them from being considered true Jews. The text is saying unbelieving Jews will one day bow before Messiah's people and learn that God loves Messiah's congregation. What many scholars feel is in view is Paul's Romans 11 statement that all Israel will be saved. That is, the majority of unbelieving Jews will be saved and recognize Messiah, at the same time paying homage to the Christians who believed in Messiah prior to them. Indeed, Romans 11:26-28 affirms that unbelieving Israel will be saved, and that although right now they are enemies of the gospel, nevertheless, in regards to election, they are beloved by God for the sake of their believing Jewish forefathers. This is what is most likely in view here when Revelation 3:9 says unbelieving Jews will one day pay homage and bow to Messiah's people, not this crazy idea of slavery. Fake black Israelites also claim the dragon or Satan of Revelation 12, 13, 16, and 20 is the white man, and that since Revelation 22 says the dragon was bound for 1,000 years, this must mean whites will be bound with chains and made slaves of fake black Israelites for 1,000 years in the future millennial kingdom. As for Revelation 22:3 saying that an angel will bind Satan for 1,000 years so he can no longer deceive the nations, this is not about the white man. We know this is about an actual celestial angelic figure being bound, since, as New Testament scholar Craig Keener notes, the idea of binding an evil angel appears regularly in Jewish texts. Thus, in one widely read Jewish work, God commands an archangel to bind and so immobilize a leader of rebellious angels until he will be cast into the fire on the day of judgment. Likewise, another Jewish work written some 2 centuries before Revelation recounts good angels binding evil angels until the day of judgment. Hence, when we go back to the cultural thought world of the book of Revelation, we see ancient Jewish textual evidence that Satan being bound by an angel means Satan is an actual angelic celestial being, and not the white race. Fake black Israelites also claim that when the book of Obadiah talks about Edom and its fall, it is talking about white America's future rise and collapse, and that forces, you soar aloft like the eagle. Since one of America's common symbols is the eagle, they argue this is proof white America is being discussed. However, this is not decisive, and biblical history refutes this theory. The Book of Obadiah is a hostile oracle against the Edomites. Contrary to the fake black Israelite claim that the hostility is due to whites enslaving African Americans, it is actually because of Edom's harsh treatment toward ancient Israelites in antiquity. For example, Edom refused to let Israel pass through Edomite territory on their way from Egypt to the land of Canaan. Saul and King David both fought against Edom, and Edom betrayed Judah when Babylon destroyed Jerusalem and exiled the Jews in 586 BC. Due to such actions, Obadiah predicted the destruction of Edom, and such predictions of destruction have already been fulfilled in history. They are not about white people or America today. Obadiah 1:4 predicts Edom would be brought down, and verses 5-7 predict Edom would be ransacked, pillaged, deported, and betrayed by their allies. These things were all fulfilled when the Babylonian ruler, Nabonidus, who reigned from 555 to 539 BC, first allied with Edom and then turned his back on them. Edom's final destruction as a kingdom happened in the 5th century BC when the Nabatean Arabs conquered them and occupied their land. Also, verses 18 and 19 and 21 predict the house of Esau would be made stubble, that the people from the Negev, that is Jews in southern Judah, would then become masters of the mountains of Esau. In history, the Jews of Negev did control the mountains of Esau in fulfillment of this Obadiah prophecy. The post-exilic region of Judah did not extend beyond Bithzer, north of Hebron. Hebron and the neighboring towns in the Negev were all occupied by Edomites. But the Maccabean Wars in the 2nd century BC led to the Israelites conquering the Edomites living there and then controlling their land in direct fulfillment of this prophecy. Fake black Israelites also claim Isaiah 14:1-2 supports their idea of murdering and enslaving whites in the future kingdom of God. For the Lord will have compassion on Jacob and will again choose Israel, and will set them in their own land, and sojourners will join them and will attach themselves to the house of Jacob, and the peoples will take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel will possess them in the Lord's land as male and female slaves. They will take captive those who were their captors and rule over those who oppressed them, end quote. However, Isaiah was written in the 8th century BC, and in ancient context, Isaiah 13:1-14:23 is a prophecy against ancient Babylon regarding its judgment and destruction, and how the ancient Jews would return to Israel from Babylonian exile. This was fulfilled when Persian king Cyrus the Great destroyed Babylon in 538 BC. These Persians then ended the Jewish exile in 515 BC, leading to many of the Jewish exiles returning to Jerusalem in direct fulfillment of this Isaiah prophecy. And as for Isaiah 14:1-2 saying sojourners would join the Israelites and come to Jerusalem and be possessed by the Israelites, Ezra 1:1-4 and 6:1-12 explain this and note Cyrus, king of Persia, decreed that when the Jews left Babylonian exile and went back to Jerusalem, non-Israelite neighbors were to help the Jews return and rebuild Jerusalem with them, and in that sense be utilized or possessed by Israel. Lastly, fake black Israelites appeal to the invalid Old Testament apocryphal book, 2 Ezra 6:8-9, in order to claim the final kingdom of God and fake black Israelites will destroy the Caucasian Edomite kingdom led by America, and that the kingdom of Jacob or fake black Israelites will replace it. Quote, "And he said unto me, from Abraham unto Isaac, when Jacob and Esau were born of him, Jacob's hand held first the heel of Esau, for Esau is the end of the world, and Jacob is the beginning of it that followeth." However, no scholars who study this text see Esau as a reference to all white people led by America. Instead, most scholars note 2 Ezra 6:8-10 derives from the aftermath of the destruction of 70 CE. In her commentary on 2 Ezra, Robin Darling Young agrees. We know this because the work is not alluded to before the 2nd century AD, and because, like the Book of Revelation, written near the same time, it often equates Babylon with Rome. So in light of the date and reason of writing, most scholars conclude in this text Esau is being equated with the ancient Roman Empire, which recently destroyed Jerusalem in AD 70. The conclusion is the future fall of the Roman Empire would lead to the new age or world of Israel's kingdom reign. Thus, this has nothing to do with all white people or America. The point is, a first century Jew angry at Rome after the destruction of Jerusalem predicted Rome would one day collapse, and he pretended to be Ezra writing 400 years earlier in order to get his point across. The first century Rabbi Akiva likewise connected Esau to the Roman Empire, and so such a connection existed in the days of 2nd Ezra's composition. Many fake black Israelites teach the false Hindu doctrine of reincarnation, and they misuse a few biblical texts to do so. For example, they note how in Malachi 4:5, there's a prediction that God would send Elijah the prophet, who was already ascended and in heaven. And in the Gospels, the people wondered if Jesus was John the Baptist, Elijah, or one of the prophets. However, this is not affirming reincarnation. Luke 1:17 explains John the Baptist fulfilled the Malachi 4:5 Elijah prediction